So I saw The Big Sick.
So did I.
I loved it.
Loved it. 5 stars.
Now, here's what I'm going to say to you.
Okay.
There are not a lot of people that I know, of my friends, who wanted to go see it based on the title. The title sounds awful. And when you know the premise that the girl is in a coma for most of it.
Although people went to go see While You Were Sleeping, same kind of thing,
It is kind of. You're right, because it's about the relationships that happen outside of her hospital room. But here's what I want to say about it.
Okay.
I loved Holly Hunter. I've always loved Holly Hunter.
Well, she's amazing.
She was brilliant. I mean, there were little touches that she did in this that so moved me. And I didn't even know if the director told her to do or not. It was just wonderful. But here's what I'm also going to say.
Okay.
Hashtag surprise. Ray Romano. WTF. He was lovely.
He was great. Yeah. Yeah. I think when you get him away from an annoying character, and somebody else was playing the stand-up comic, so he could just be the worried dad.
Correct.
You know, and I also think maybe when you get, you know, paired with Oscar winner Holly Hunter in all of your scenes, you just decide to calm the shtick down a little
and something rubs off.
Yeah.
Because he was lovely. Do I think he is as good as she is? No, he's not.
Yeah.
But he was wonderful. I thought it was a lovely story, and what's better is it's true.
Yeah. So here's the two things I really want to say about it. One, I went into it thinking, you know, cross-cultural love story, right? And I just kind of thought it's going to hit you over the head. It didn't.
Mm-mm.
It didn't hit you over the head. I mean, it was there. Like, he's Pakistani. Yeah. She's white. His parents are not thrilled with this whole thing. It's there. But it doesn't, like, beat you over the head with it and give you some lecture. The other thing about it that I thought was so great, it's so funny. Even when it's at its saddest.
Yes.
It gets laughs out of just how ridiculous life is. And so it is, she gets into a coma.
Yeah.
It's called The Big Sick. But it is funny. And it's 2 hours of nonstop funny. It is funny, funny, funny. I loved it.
I loved it. And I just, one reason we wanted to talk about it is that we really want people to see that. Because don't be put off by the name of it or what you think it's about.
Or Ray Romano.
Or Ray Romano, for God's sake.
5 stars.
When the chaos of popular culture makes your brain hurt, you really need belief in the form of a transfusion of analysis and humor. It's time for a POPeration. Join hosts Eric and Stacey as they dissect popular culture one bloody organ at a time. It's just what the doctor ordered.
Hello, I'm Eric.
I'm Stacey, and you're listening to POPeration.
So today, what are we talking about, Stacey?
We're talking about binge watching television show.
I know that's not wrong.
We're talking about all the Ben and Jerry that you're eating at 12 o'clock at night. No, we're not. That's okay. It's the watching of the TV at 12 hours at a time. That's a problem.
Well, it is. Or binging. See, to me, binging doesn't necessarily mean I'm sitting in front of my TV show and watching. You know, what it means is if I want to watch 4 episodes in a row, I can, because these streaming services are just plopping entire seasons like all at once.
Right.
Like, boom.
That is exactly what they're doing. And that's Hulu. That's Amazon. That's mostly, I mean, Netflix, I guess, started it.
Yeah, they did.
Was it House of Cards?
House of Cards was the first one. It was about 5 years ago.
Oh, my God.
So they're now on season 5 of House of Cards. And I remember when House of Cards was the thing, and I had Netflix. I already had Netflix hooked up to my TV, and I mostly watched movies on it. They had not done a lot of original content at that point. And all of a sudden, it was like, there's this new thing, House of Cards, and I like Robin Wright, and I like Kevin Spacey. Mm-hmm. And I thought, and I'd heard of the British show. I'd never seen it.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, okay, this could be interesting. And then when I looked at it, it was like season 1, and I was like, 10 or 12 episodes were on season. And I was just like, what is this? I was initially not a fan because it was different and I wasn't used to that.
Well, so it dropped. Here's the thing. I did see the House of Cards, the British one.
Uh-huh.
Back in the day in the 70s, it was on PBS, Masterpiece Theater.
Yep.
Ian Richardson, yeah. Oh my gosh, it was wonderful. I loved it.
Yeah.
It was a three 2-hour movies, basically, is what the original House of Cards was.
Yep. And they did 3 seasons of that, right?
Well,
so
each one.
That was season 1,
yes.
Was the 3 2-hour movies.
Right.
Yep.
And then you had season 2 and then season 3. There were 3, you're correct. There were 3 seasons, and each season had 6 hours.
Yep.
In 2 hour increments. And I loved it. So when this came, I thought, oh, cool. And of course, I'm like you. I liked both Kevin, like all the actors in it. So I did watch season one of it. I did not watch it all at once. And what I have come to realize is that I didn't have an opinion about it. I didn't mind it because sometimes when I'm watching a show, I get mad when there's a cliffhanger and I have to wait a week.
Yeah.
So that was my issue. So this didn't bother me in that respect. But here's my problem. Stuff drops and people watch it literally. They'll watch all 15 hours at one sitting.
In a weekend.
On a weekend.
Yep.
And then that's all they're talking about the next week, whatever. I can't keep up. I haven't watched anything. I don't do that. And what I literally realized in the last month, I'm not a binge watcher.
I'm not a binge watcher in that I don't want to watch an entire television series in one weekend.
I can't do it.
But I love the streaming kind of bingey way that episodes drop now, because I can watch television now completely on my own schedule.
Yes.
I don't have to wait until Wednesday for a show. Now a bingey show recently was The Handmaid's Tale.
Yes.
On Hulu.
OMG.
Which I really enjoyed. Did you see it?
I did not watch it.
Okay.
I have a reason why I didn't watch it.
Okay. Why is that? Go ahead. Okay.
My reason is because I watched the movie.
Uh-huh.
Back in, I think it was the 80s, with Miranda Richardson.
Natasha Richardson,
I believe. No, I'm sorry. You're right. Natasha Richardson and Faye Dunaway.
Robert Duvall.
And Aidan Quinn.
Yep.
I watched that movie.
Mm-hmm.
It was very disturbing.
Okay.
I still remember. I still have flashbacks to it. Even before this new Handmaids, there were things that I would go, oh, that reminds me of. That's how much it affected me. There's no effing way I'm going to sit down and put myself through that kind of intensity that this 18,000 hour thing is. I'm not doing it. I know it's good. I know it's high quality, but that's just not, I can't put myself.
Yeah. So
I have only one life.
In this political climate, I was also worried that The Handmaid's Tale would be kind of depressing.
Duh.
What I found was, though, what's interesting about it to me is that it is depressing and it's also super inspiring. Because what this is able to do, taking this, what was a 2 hour movie and turning it into a 10 hour TV show, is that it really kind of gets into what it means to be a member of a resistance. And so a lot of it is about her, that this main character, Offred, her at first unwillingness to be a resistor. And then this notion where she's surrounded, she learns that all of these handmaids that she believes are good little girls who follow the rules and, you know, say blessed be the fruit wherever they go, they're all working together. Not all of them, but a lot of them. And so this kind of undercover, first of all, it's exciting. And second of all, it kind of gives her life purpose. And she's certainly not happier than she was before this entire revolution, but she has more purpose now as a handmaid who's working against this nefarious government than she did before. In fact, one of the lines that couldn't have been in the movie because it wasn't in the novel and it's really of its time. You could only say this in 2017, but the line that really got to me in The Handmaid's Tale was, "We didn't look up from our screens before it was too late." And they were all looking at like cell phones and stuff.
Right.
And it was just all about how, wow, you know, I mean, it was a real comment on us and like, what should we be doing now so that we don't get to. Anyway, my point about The Handmaid's Tale was that what they did is they dropped three episodes, only three at once to kind of get you hooked. And then they waited until Wednesdays to drop the additional episodes. So you did have to wait for a week to go see The Handmaid's Tale. You know, you couldn't just watch all 10 episodes at once.
Were they dropping one a week?
One a week.
Oh, wow.
So this was kind of like a 7 week span.
Okay.
To watch this entire show.
That explains.
Which you didn't have, you know, but which was different. And it frustrated me. So what I've learned is that I've become the person who actually likes it when the entire season drops at once.
As I said, I'm good with that because I like the ability to go and watch the next one whenever I want to. I'll tell you, here's one that is a British one called, it's Loch Ness.
Okay.
And they're dropping it one a week.
Uh-huh.
It's killing me.
What's the service?
It's Acorn on Netflix.
Okay.
It's, you have to get a subscription to the British.
Gotcha. It's the
channel.
Anglophile Netflix.
It is. It really is. And it has a lot of British mysteries or whatever, but it's Loch Ness. And I thought it had all of them when I started because there were four. Well, that was because I had, that was the fourth week. I was an idiot. So now I have to wait. I'm so mad.
Right? It's because it's, I got turned us into a very kind of short attention span. Like, I can't believe I have to wait a week.
Yeah.
Watch this show. Right. Right. So, we're now kind of in the throng of your favorite show, Game of Thrones. yeah, you don't watch it. I know we've talked about this. Episode 9. We talked about this. Yeah. But I do watch it and I love it. And waiting every Sunday is killing me, you know, because it's just like I've so gotten used to this notion. So we have five bingeables on our list that we're going to talk to in some depth.
But
we wanted to give quick mention to some others.
There's some honorable mention that are really, really good out there. There's Man in the High Castle, which I saw the first episode. It's
that was so good.
It's spooky as hell.
That's an Amazon show.
Right.
I wasn't interested in season two because we are where we are politically. Well, it was interesting when Obama was in office, but now I'm afraid it's going to be scary. I should go back and watch season two. I really did enjoy season one.
Yeah, it's great. Sense8, which I did not see.
Which got canceled, Netflix has said they're going to do a 2-hour movie to wrap up all the loose ends because they did not end at a satisfying place. So thank you, Netflix gods, for that.
Transparent. Which
Allison talked a lot when we had her on the show. She enjoyed that. That's another Amazon show.
Right, and I've seen that, and it's very, very good. But they dropped all those at one time. Grace and Frankie, which is Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin.
Hopefully guest starring Dolly Parton at some point. They need to bring her in just for a little bit. Like, that just needs to happen because they all enjoy each other. I guess when Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin met on the set of 9 to 5, they just really took a shine to each other. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't that Dolly was on the outs. It was just that these two women just discovered they had so much in common.
Different backgrounds.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did Dolly and the other two.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I get that.
So they've been itching to work together forever, and now they brought this thing, Grace and Frankie, which I think is just charming.
That's the perfect word for it. I think it's charming as well. It's a good one. The OA, I have not seen.
I saw that, and that was weirdly addictive, but it's a mind-trippy kind of show. Allison mentioned that when we were doing our show on transgender issues as well. There is a very minor character who's trans, a trans teenager. But it's really about the thing you have to kind of believe in order to watch the show, if you don't already believe this, is that there is this thing called an afterlife. And so what this show is all about is that there's actually two kinds of humans in the world, mm-hmm. and one of them can come back if they choose to whenever they die. And so that's what, according to this show, near-death experiences are like. When people die for a short time and then are revived and come back, it means that they're this different kind of species. And they can.
A lot of them?
And well, they're enough that it's kind of like the mutants and the X-Men. They're both kinds. They're just people. But they do have this ability to step in and out if they choose to. And most of the time, they choose not to because when they die, they go to this kind of paradise. And, you know, why would you want to come back from that? But people who have unfinished business can do that. And so it starts off this young girl who was abducted many years ago, a blind adopted daughter comes back and it's been 5 years and now she can see. And that's the opening, like, how did you get your sight back and where have you been all this time? And that's kind of where the mystery starts. But then you find out she's one of these people, and I won't spoil it because it's interesting.
Okay.
Another one we want to talk about is Stranger Things, which was something of a phenomenon when it dropped last summer,
I believe. It was huge. That's all anybody would talk about. That's all I saw on Facebook. That's all anybody would tweet about, and I'm over it. And those crazy little sad-looking little 70s-looking kids were everywhere. Every fucking where.
You know, it was it was nice to see Winona Ryder again, I thought.
Well, oh, my gosh. Asterisk. Winona Ryder, do you remember that? It was like, it ended up being a gif, I think, but it was her when they got some award. I don't know whether it was an Emmy. I don't know what it was,
okay.
But she was up there and the group, everybody was up there.
Yep.
And for some reason, I don't know what was being said, but the camera was just on her and she was making all those weird ass faces. Do you remember that?
I never saw that.
Oh my. Okay. You're going to have to look it up.
Okay.
And we'll find
all
it.
Right.
And we'll put it on the blog. But it was I sat there and I didn't even know she was in Stranger Things because, again, I didn't watch it because it was, I didn't, I don't have that kind of freaking time.
It was ubiquitous is the word I think you were looking for.
Was that the word
I
was
looking for? That's the word you're looking for.
That's funny because I'm fairly sure I've never, ever, ever used that word. That's not true. But not recently. That's for damn sure. But anyway, I just thought I'd say that Winona, I suppose it's good she has a job.
Any more we want to mention before we get into our list?
Oh, yes. Glow just dropped.
Okay.
Like two or three. Gorgeous Ladies of Wrestling. Now,
which was a real show.
It was
the 80s.
A real show.
And this
in
is
the
a
80s.
Show about
Correct.
The 80s
Mark
show.
Mark
so it's a
plays
period piece.
This guy in charge of it.
Uh-huh.
Can't remember her name. Chick from Community.
Okay.
Allison, whatever.
Okay.
She is the main lead, at least in the getting you into the whole story. She's uh-huh. an actress looking for work. And
she becomes a glow girl.
She finds out that her agent says, okay, she can't get her job. She just can't get a job, can't get a job. And they go through some of the audition in episode one. They go through some of her auditions, which they're funny, but they're also heartbreaking because any of us who have ever acted uh-huh. and auditioned, it's like really, really true.
The audition montage is such a trope, but if it's done well, anybody who's ever been an actor can really sympathize.
Wow, that hurt, but it's real. So she can't get a job. Her agent is finally, okay, there is this one thing. They're going to start this lady wrestling thing. And she's like, are you serious? And so she goes and there's these other people auditioning. I haven't watched the whole thing because as I've said earlier, I'm not a binger, but I've watched the first episode. I think the idea is going to be kind of like the Orange is the New Black in that you get to know each of these women and they have their own stories. In the meantime, there is this show they have to put on called Gorgeous Ladies of Wrestling. And again, it's very 80s. So you have all of the wonderful fashion choices.
I hear this lead actually did perm her hair, like actually got an 80s perm so she could be in the show.
So method.
It's very dedicated.
You know, yeah.
Would you do it?
Would I perm my hair?
Yes.
Would I perm my hair? Here's what I'm going to say. So you have her going all the way to the hair cuttery to perm her hair. And then you have all these other guys who like starve them. You know, that you have, was it Matt Damon who starved himself to a stick
uh-huh.
for Saving Private Ryan? That I wouldn't do. That's okay. Where I am. Would I perm my hair? Hells yes.
Good. Okay, good.
I mean, that's absurd. That's easy to do. And so when you sit there, you say that to me, I'm like, what a sacrifice for her. That's not a sacrifice. She got her hair curled.
Yeah, but
you
now
were looking
she
at me
is
like, a... now she has a perm. Oh my God, Eric.
It was kind of a joke, but okay.
I know. But I'm just like, that's just ridiculous. Anyway, that is, I think that it's actually quite good. It's really new. It's like in the last 4 or 5 weeks, it's dropped. It's worth a look.
Excellent. So the last one we probably should mention, kind of on the honorable mention list, because we're not going to get to it later, and you just named it a second ago, is Orange is the New Black, which is the ladies' prison show,
like,
which started off as like this annoying white girl goes to prison, right? And mm-hmm. and when it was all centered on Piper, I was like, I don't know if this is going to last for me. But because they did such a great job of introducing you to all the different women who are there, most of whom actually did commit a crime, including Piper. Like, they're all, right. like, very few of them were framed and really shouldn't be in prison. There's a couple of those just to spice it up a little bit. Really, really good. This last season, and this is what I think is so great about bingeable shows, it was 10 episodes that span 3 days. So if you were to watch the last season of Orange is the New Black in a traditional kind of way, you'd be spending 10 weeks on 3 days in this prison.
Well,
but as it is,
24.
24 did that. You're right. That was an interesting kind of format thing. I didn't enjoy that show nearly as much as I enjoy this one. So that's probably why I don't, respond to it that way. But it was great being it. So I watched the new season of Orange is the New Black probably in 5 or 6 days. But I really did feel that kind of compressed amount of time because it didn't take that long for me to watch it. And it did, you really got that this was the finale was 3 days after the season opener. And it actually was the same day of the finale of season 4. So the finale of season 4, the prisoners kind of, spoiler, the prisoners kind of took over. There was a riot and they subdued some officers. And then the entirety of season 5 were those next 3 days. And I imagine that season 6 will pick up that day.
Okay.
You know, and so it'll be interesting to kind of see how, you know, this like weeks amount of time is spanning now three seasons of television.
Well, I think
you can do that now.
Yeah. And I think one thing about a good thing about the binge for producers is that if you get people hooked, then you have them hooked and you probably won't lose them the next season that comes on. The problem that network televisions have had is that so you have this show, people get hooked, then you're in reruns.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're in, you know, stupid summer shows.
Yeah.
And then sometimes people have lost interest by fall.
Well, and the same thing I think can happen with the binge in a different kind of way is that you watch an entire series over a weekend and then the next season doesn't come out for another year. And literally, it's been a year since you've watched
the
show.
That's true, but at the same time, you can go back.
Fall off. Yes.
You can go back. And I did that with Sherlock, which was not a binge thing, but they only did three episodes.
But I've binged Sherlock before.
Correct. Now you can because there's enough seasons, but it was only three shows at a pop. And so it was like, there were as a year and a half in between seasons, and so you're able to via Netflix or Amazon, whatever, to go back and watch those. So that is a plus.
Yeah. So we're going to talk about five bingeable shows here, whether you decide to binge them or not. We've got five on our list. Let's go through one of them, and then we'll take a break, and then we'll come back and do the other four. The first one on our list is The Crown. Mm-hmm. It's a Netflix show. Mm-hmm. I read somewhere the most expensive per episode show ever made for television, which surprises me. Yeah, that surprised me too. And I read that. I'll have to check that out and see if that's actually real. Well, they're paying for all the period costumes. They're paying for recreating the inside of Buckingham Palace, which is not easy to do.
Wait, are they saying it's more expensive than Game of Thrones?
Yeah, and Sense8, which went all over the world. So, I mean...
But Game of Thrones, like, makes up shit. I mean, they've made up worlds. They've created worlds.
And they have dragons. But you can make a dragon on a computer.
A dragon is CGI.
Yeah, right? So you pay a little bit for the computer program. The other thing I think they're paying for, though, with The Crown, is PhD-level historians that make sure they get it all right.
They're paying for their consultants.
Yeah. I mean, they literally have a bevy of history buffs who are there to make sure that this is a really accurate representation of Queen Elizabeth II's first decade.
Which is what The Crown is about.
Exactly. So, but yeah, I don't know. That's an interesting question, but I did read somewhere the most expensive show ever. So is it worth it? What do you think?
Okay. I can't answer is it worth it because I didn't know that fact and I'm stunned. Here's what's funny for me. So first I'll say, yes, I do like it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm also watching on PBS Victoria.
Okay.
Which is about Queen Victoria.
Yeah.
Another queen. The first girl. The first queen, actually. No.
Well, Queen Elizabeth I.
Sorry, sorry. But I'm sorry. I don't know why I said that. Queen Victoria. And it's fascinating because both of them are about the coming into their own of these monarchs.
Yeah.
And there are some definite similarities to it. And the misogyny, hashtag misogyny was real. So it's kind of fun. I'm enjoying watching it because I'm kind of comparing it. I'm sitting there looking at the trials and tribulations that each of them had to go through at certain ages that they were. Granted, they had different upbringings and it was a different century and all of that. I enjoy it, but I'm a little bit of an Anglophile. And
yes, you are. Anyone who's met you, that's not an insult. It's just, but you are.
Well, sometimes it's
You like the British things.
I do like the Brit things, but I think that The Crown, she's still alive. And I think that's part of what's fascinating about this.
Yes.
Is that we're watching a fictionalized version of this woman who at any time could come out and say that's a lie. She's not going to. She's very possibly not watching it. But my point being that
I wouldn't want to if I were her. Watch
because
this.
There's
although
a
it's
lot
a
of
very
drama.
Dignified portrait of her.
No, I think
less
I think
so
she comes
about
out.
Her sister and her husband.
And her husband.
Yeah.
I found
that was the most fascinating
the
part
sister,
for me.
Not so much. The sister's always been denigrated. You listen to any of Joan Rivers' comedy in the 80s or 90s, she compared her to a horse.
That's true.
Always.
Not very nice. But I never realized, like, she was saucy. Princess Margaret. I mean, she had like this affair with this man, and you know,
she was a rebel, and she fought against.
I learned a lot about Princess Margaret watching the show, actually, that I wasn't. I don't know that I was acutely aware.
Keep in mind that it's to an extent fictionalized. You know, they have facts at their fingertips, but you know,
but this relationship was a national scandal that made headlines. And
But that's what's interesting to me is that watching, knowing where the Queen is now, and where everybody is now.
Yep.
And looking at the beginnings to say, I mean, it's just kind of fascinating to see how it got where it was.
Yeah. Well, I lived in the UK. I lived in the UK for 2 years.
That's right, you did.
And when I was there, Prince Philip was always seen as just this very supportive, you know, and he was a dad, right? I mean, you know, Charles and Andrew and Edward, they were all adults, and Anne, but by the time I was there, and, you know, Prince Philip was the dad of the royal family.
But also, you and I are of an age where they were grown-ups. You know, Charles was a grown-up by the time. So I
know. Watching him as a little toddler is interesting. So watching Matt Smith as a very young Prince Philip, who's quite frankly really annoyed that his wife has been taken from him when they thought they would have this like long unencumbered marriage, you know, unencumbered by the throne because Liz's dad should have lived a lot longer than he did. And suddenly she's what, 23, 24, and she's becoming queen. And he's really just kind of really annoyed by it and not very supportive of this whole royalty thing. That was fascinating for me. I really enjoyed that.
It was interesting to me because it kind of goes with, because I've been watching, there's some other documentaries on Netflix and Amazon that you can find about the royal family, as of course there want to be. And I was watching something about the royal photographer. And so when I was watching The Crown and that whole wedding thing happened, it was interesting because they were, it was pretty true, but not even as much. Apparently, Philip, he wanted to be in charge of the wedding, and he really wanted it to be all what he wanted it to be. But, of course, that whole Mountbatten thing, too, that was hugely real.
Yes.
Hugely real. And it's fascinating to have seen it in a documentary, and then you see them play it out, and you go, oh, that's how it could have played out. And it's you know what it is? It's giving personalities to these people that have actually only been 2D to me.
Yeah.
And now they're 3D.
Yeah.
Which, as I said, it's a fictionalized 3D, but it's still interesting. And it does, it's kind of like the Queen when Helen Mirren did that whole movie about the Queen during the Diana crisis. If I were Elizabeth, I'd be saying, please more of that, because it makes you seem more human, dear. That's kind of how I feel about the
Crown.
And
yet,
as well,
you can also see her, you know, this idea that she's taking on this mantle of queen and doing what's the best for her country, which might not be humanizing all the time. You know, she does.
It
this show
be.
Seems to be about like accepting the fact that you're going to be a symbol, and the importance of that symbol. Couple things I have to say before we drop this one is that John Lithgow was amazing as Winston Churchill. I really enjoyed his performance. Did he win an Emmy?
I don't know. I thought he was fine. I didn't love it.
Oh, really? Oh, I thought he was fantastic.
I think I saw whatever Anthony Hopkins did when he did Churchill. I liked him better.
Okay.
Lithgow, I just kind of, and it wasn't that long ago that I saw the Anthony Hopkins one. And so when I saw John, I was like, oh, that's a lot of makeup. You know what I mean?
I guess I really enjoyed what I loved about his performance was the kind of the slow burn between I can control this woman to his growing to respect her.
Oh, no, John Lithgow is a great actor.
Yeah.
So he puts all of that
and
out
there. And then
there
was he had a monologue that he did during the episode where his portrait was being painted that, you know, it was one of those kind of Citizen Kane Rosebud moments where you just realize this pain in the ass like actually has this huge ache in his heart. And it needed a good actor to pull that off. Gary Oldman is about to play Churchill in something
that,
else.
And I'm fascinated. We have the trailer on our website because I'm fascinated to see how that's going to roll. Here's my problem with John Lithgow. It's not his performance. My problem is the whole time I was aware it was John Lithgow playing Winston Churchill. I forget that Claire Foy is not Queen Elizabeth. I forget. And I'm thinking I'm watching a documentary. But once John Lithgow, I'm like, oh, it's John Lithgow as Winston Churchill in The Crown. That's
third Churchill from the sun. Is that kind of what?
That all goes. Nice pull.
Right?
That all goes through my head when he walks in. And then I enjoy his performance and I go, yes, that's kind of what I've seen that their relationship was. but I'm always aware he's an actor, so that's my problem.
Okay. All right. Well, I liked him. We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we've got four more bingeables to discuss, so we'll be right back.
Binging is a good thing. You can binge anything, including podcasts. Miss an episode? Come binge listen to past episodes of POPeration from your favorite podcast location. More binging when Eric and Stacey return.
So we're back here on POPeration. I'm Stacey.
I'm Eric.
We are talking about the stuff you binge, and I mean on the TV, not in the fridge. Although binging, you could do both. You could totally do both.
Oh, you know, it's hard not to sometimes. Like when you're, you know, like Netflix and takeout is a really irresistible combination.
Because what you're going to do, all you have to do is get up and walk to the door to get the stuff. And you sit right back down because you pressed pause.
Yeah.
You pressed pause. Yeah. You didn't stop it.
Alexa, order me the Chinese usual.
Now you've got Alexa, so you can that, do that.
Can that happen? Gosh, can I like program my Echo to send me food?
You totally probably can. Well, you know, they bought Whole Foods or they're buying or whatever.
Oh, my God.
Is.
I want a Whole Foods slice of pepperoni pizza delivered to my door with free shipping.
You're going
to
binge on Alexa.
Can that happen?
You're going to marry Alexa and your parents are going to be so happy. Because they'll go, it's a girl's name. So, anyway.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Dad. Okay.
Yeah. So, here's one that I've seen one episode, and it's in the Game of Thrones category for me. I appreciate it. I think it's good. It's so effing violent. And I just couldn't get it.
I mean, I have a high bar for violence, so it's really so. Quick little side note, and maybe this is a moment of non-zen for later. I once was talking to our friends Faye and Bonnie, and I said to them, "You really need to see Fargo." And they said, "Is it violent?" And I said, "I don't think so, not really."
God, no, you didn't say that.
I didn't remember. I mean,
you're
to me,
idiot.
It was fun.
It's all violence.
I know, but to me, it was just like to me. All I could remember was, "I guess that was your accomplice in the wood chipper," and I thought it was so funny.
It's a funny line, but you understand it's also about a wood chipper that people went through.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Well, you know, so they saw that, and then afterwards, they're like, "We're never speaking to you again. We're, or at least we're never taking like you a judge of what is acceptable levels of violence, because I have a very high bar.
Tolerance.
Anywho. So, yes, Jessica Jones, there's, to me, it's more about, it's the psychological violence, though. I mean, the action scenes, you know, it's a superhero-y movie, and so that, to me, is just, is that what you're talking about in terms
that's
of violence? People getting their faces kicked
No. I can handle some gruesomeness. Mm-hmm. That doesn't usually bother me, although violence for violence's sake, my tolerance has lessened over the years. I just can't stand as much. There needs to be a reason. But, and also if there's funniness, like Deadpool, you know, he's funny and he's violent.
Yep.
So I can tolerate it.
Okay.
But Jessica Jones, I think you're right. I think it was that psychological, it was exhausting.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a brilliant show. I've actually seen it twice. I got sucked into it again.
Crap.
Yes, I got sucked into it again, and I ended up binging the whole thing again because I was bored and there was nothing else around, and I was like, I'm going to watch Jessica Jones again, and I did.
There's nothing to binge, Eric.
Well, nothing I was interested in in that moment. So I watched it twice, and it's a great mystery. It's a great kind of psychological thriller, but at its core, it has a lot to say really about post-traumatic stress disorder is what it's really about, but wrapped up in kind of this superhero action girl kind of package. I appreciate the fact that Jessica Jones as a character is snarky and kind of bitter, and she's kind of fun that way.
Well, everybody's got flaws in this.
Yes.
Everybody is.
But she doesn't whine. She doesn't cry. And she's been through a lot.
Also, everybody's kind of angry, if I recall.
A little bit. I mean, you know, she has reason to be angry. Okay.
No,
so
again,
she's got,
it's not that nobody has a reason.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that there's a lot of anger.
Yeah. Yeah. So she's not, I didn't want it to sound like, you know, she's kind of came out of the womb angry. You know, she's been hurt.
Victimized.
So, yeah. So I don't want to get into too much about why, because the mystery at the heart of it is, but she was abducted and she was basically held prisoner by this guy named Kilgrave. No symbolism there at all.
I'm just pass.
Based on a comic book. So this guy, like, basically his superpower was mind control. And so he could make her do whatever he wanted to. And now he's gone. And he died. And that, you know, that part of her life is over and she's having a hard time moving on. And her sister wants to help and is kind of frustrated that she can't. And she runs this little PI investigation firm thing. And she's got a couple of nifty little superpowers that help her do that job pretty well. And she becomes convinced that Kilgrave is back. And so the initial mystery is he or isn't he, or is this the PTSD kind of, you know, rearing its ugly head again?
Isn't one of her boyfriends also a superhero?
She meets Luke Cage halfway through the show, who then he got his own Netflix series like six months later.
I remember him being in her show.
Yeah, so he was introduced in her show. And then Rosario Dawson plays this character who's a nurse in New York who ties together. She's in Daredevil. She's in Jessica Jones. She's in Luke Cage.
I didn't get far enough to see her.
So. She's also in Iron Fist. And now The Defenders, which is the team show of all four of them, is coming out.
Is that a show or a movie?
It's a show. Oh, okay. It's another Netflix thing. Okay. But interestingly, it does tie into the rest of this whole Marvel thing because they mention in a couple of, you miss it. They don't call them the Avengers, but they talk about when the thing happened. And it's that moment in the Avengers when they basically destroyed half of New York City, having this big showdown with the aliens. So they live in a world where all of these other characters take part, but this is a very localized piece, a little neighborhood in New York. And these just happen to be these folks with superheroes who are not making world headlines. They're just kind of a little bit more hometown.
Okay.
Anyway, super addictive. David Tennant is in this and he is brilliant. God, he's so good.
Without spoiling it?
We can talk about whether he's Kilgrave.
Oh, okay.
He's the mind control. So guess what? Spoiler, he's back. You find out he's back in episode two.
Oh,
so not a huge spoiler because he's in the whole thing. But yes, he is back.
And he's good.
And so,
He's good.
And of course he's good. But she has to avoid contact with him because if she's in the same room with him, boop, she's back into the mind control thing. So how does she defeat this man from a distance, knowing that he's doing this to other people, and he's a complete sociopath who can control? So he can walk into an apartment and say, "I'm staying, feed me dinner." And they'll go, "Okay." And they'll just do it. And they'll hate themselves while they're doing it, but they'll do it anyway. Mm-hmm. That's his whole superpower. He's terrifying, but so great. So, yeah, if you're a David Tennant fan, this is such a brilliant turn by him. It's something you should probably see.
Well, I mean, I watched Broadchurch, which we didn't mention and that was one of those, which Broadchurch 3
is coming out. I like the British one.
Oh, no, I didn't watch the American one.
Yeah. He's also in the American one, you know.
I know, and that was bullshit. I'm sorry. I watched 5 minutes and went, and I'm out.
Really? I didn't even try. I just wanted, I like the British one so much, I was just in there.
Yeah, I was out. No, the third one's coming out, though. The third Broadchurch is coming out.
Good, I think it's the final.
But yeah. But yes, anyway, no, I love him, but I don't know if I can handle all the, it was very stressful. That first episode was very stressful.
I can get that. I can stand with you there.
I can't believe you watched it twice.
Oh, but it was so good. So good. So now let's turn a corner. We're going to turn a hard right turn from this, you know, violent superhero story into something a little bit, well, I mean, it's got
not
its own
violent
stuff. It's not as violent, but it's got its own,
feeling.
I love it too.
I just discovered it.
Yeah.
And I love it so much.
We do this a lot. We tease things and we don't say the name. The name of this show is Dear White People. And the show got some flack initially for this title. A lot of white people didn't like it.
Which is ironic. You know what? It's not ironic.
It's not ironic.
Because
it's
we have the president have. So it's not ironic.
No, it's not
Of course somebody's going to get pissed off. Of course some dumbass jackass is going to get mad.
Yeah, somebody on Twitter said something like, imagine if there was a show called Dear Black People.
Imagine.
It would be horrible. And I'm like, you're right, because that would probably be a horrible show. This is a great show.
True that. Here's my thing. And it's funny that you say that, because in the show itself, they actually, because basically this young woman, African-American at an Ivy League white school, not named, but we know it's like Harvard or Princeton or
something,
one of those, because it's in theory supposed to be in the quote post-racial time.
Yeah.
I guess post-racial means that you're not racist anymore.
Well, you know, the movie came out in 2014. Did you see the movie?
I did not see the movie.
Okay, don't. Oh, if you
really?
Like, no, don't. If you like the TV show,
I
think the TV show is better. And the TV show, the first season of Dear White People is essentially the 2-hour movie now told over 6 or 7 hours. So just basically the movie has some of the cast members in common, but not others. And I like some of the new people in the TV show either as well or maybe even a little bit better than the folks who were in the movie. Some of the folks are the same. They came back and reprised their roles in this one. And it pretty much covers the same ground, only it takes a little bit more time, and it allows you, this episode structure allows you to kind of see this entire episode is from this person's point of view, and then we're going to see it from this person's
right.
point of
so
view.
Right, so you see the same actions, certain actions, the common actions.
Mm-hmm.
You see them again.
But from a different perspective,
correct.
Which the movie did not do. The movie just basically was this big ensemble story. And, you know, it was a 2-hour thing. And it basically told this story. And you felt like most of the movie was from Samantha's perspective. Sam is this woman who has this radio show in her college radio station. And she calls it Dear White People. And she, you know, basically lectures the school. Dear White People, let me tell you what's what. And she's got a little bit of sass. And so some of the white students on campus are not fond of her. And some of the black students on campus are not fond of her.
Correct.
Right?
For either one reason or another.
Sure.
Either they feel like she's pushing too much in a rebellious resistance kind of way, or they don't think she's doing enough.
Or, spoiler, this happens 15 minutes into the first episode, so it's not really a spoiler. She has a white boyfriend.
Correct.
And therefore, is she betraying the cause, right?
Right. And she has her own conflict about that.
Uh-huh.
She's conflicted about that.
Yes. Very much.
And I remember there was this moment with she and her best friend, and she hadn't told her best friend that her boyfriend was, well, she hadn't called him her boyfriend yet, but it was her bae was white. And when her best friend found out, so Samantha's there trying to rationalize it. She said, well, you know, I am mixed. So and her best friend puts her hand up and says, no. No, you don't even go there. That's not even a thing. And of course, Samantha, it was an excuse.
Yeah.
You know, she was just trying to rationalize why.
Sure.
It was okay because she was trying to rationalize it in her own mind, too.
Yeah.
She felt guilty about having a relationship with a white guy.
Yeah. Whereas
especially
he did not feel guilty about having a relationship with a black girl. And that seems to mirror what folks go through. There is a little bit more conflictedness on the side of people of color sometimes when they are dating white people,
especially
in my anecdotal experience.
At this date and age, yes. Because of where we are.
Yeah.
That we're not in a post-racial society.
No.
That's the whole
no.
Dear White People thing is, guess what? You can call it post-racial if you want to, but it's really not.
And I think when the movie came out in 2014... Obama was in the White House, and so there was a little bit more of this mythology. Now, in 2017, I think the myth of post-racial America has gone down the tube.
Yeah,
like anybody who's paying attention
and the
can
reason
see that there's conflict.
Right, and she's talking to, though, you know, white upper class. They're in this Ivy League. You know, this is not, she's not talking to the farmers in Ohio.
Mm-hmm. No.
About post-racial.
No.
Because the farmers in Ohio know that they still don't like black people.
Yep.
Asterisk, not all farmers in Ohio hate black people. I'm just making a point. Anyway, here's my issue, or one issue I have, is I like it. I enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a white girl.
Yeah.
And I haven't done any research as far as, do African-Americans who have watched this, do they like it? Is it real to them? Is this a true look at African-Americans, how they're feeling, how they deal with each other. And that's my, should I like it? I guess there's my question. White girl says, I do like it, but I want it to be real. I want it to be true.
Yeah. Wow. No, okay. So I have a lot of feelings about that. Number one, I think that's always a really good question to ask. Whenever you're watching anything that's about a group that is not you, you know, I think that's just a responsible, in this day and age, question to ask, because people with an agenda are going to create all kinds of stuff. And is this real and is this authentic, I think is just always a good thing to be curious about. Couple things that I go to is that, A, most of the the black people that I've either read their blogs online or know in my life who've talked about the show really do enjoy it.
Good.
So there's that. But also I would look at who creates the show and who writes it and who's really kind of in charge there. And it is primarily an African-American creative team who's putting this together. Who put together the movie, and then the director of that film is also the showrunner for this show, and he's kind of in charge of the whole thing. But yeah, you know, it kind of reminds me, as you say that, the very first season of Sex and the City, the showrunner, Darren Star, gay man, the entire writer's room, from my recollection, mostly a bunch of gay men, which is why Carrie and Samantha and Charlotte and Miranda sounded more like gay men than women during that first season, as they were just swapping sex with Samantha, especially. She was just like a gay man. She was always kind of a gay man in a dress in a lot of ways. But when the show was successful and they were going to keep going with it, they very wisely, I think, said, we need more women, especially in the writer's room, to write for these voices. And they did become a little bit more human and a little bit more real when you did it that way. And so that's where I always kind of look. If I'm curious as to whether or not this is an authentic expression. And what I do love about this show is that, so there's a couple characters, Troy and Coco, who don't get their kind of perspective episodes until a little bit later in the series.
Right, but so they come off as stereotypes.
Yeah, you kind of don't like them at the beginning. Well, Samantha doesn't like them at the beginning for a couple of different reasons.
But Samantha is the first episode, and so that ends up, for me, that's like my... That's how I start.
Yeah.
My viewpoint is hers.
And so you see Troy, and Troy's father works for the university, and a couple people, I believe, in the show actually call him flat out an Uncle Tom. And Troy seems to be under a lot of pressure from his dad to do the right thing. He's the student council president or student body leader of some sort, and he's running for office as the show is beginning. And you see him kind of, you know, is he just sucking up to the establishment in some way? And then there's Coco, and a big deal about her is made about the fact that she wears her hair in a weave. And she is trying to emulate white beauty standards, apparently more so than some of the other women, and Sam, who does the radio show. Her hair is natural. And that's a big deal in the African-American community. And so you kind of see these characters from a distance, and then you see their point of view.
Right.
And you figure out what in their life has driven them to be, you know, take these different stances. And it's not a single monolithic view of what African-American college students think about. You realize there's a whole lot of ways to look at all of these problems.
Right. Well, what it does is it really does... God, this is going to sound just so simplistic and stupid and, frankly, ignorant. White. And then it's just a reiteration that people are people and they're individuals, and the color of their skin, you can't help what the color of your skin is. And so your perspective is your perspective from the get-go.
Yeah.
So the idea is that everybody's real and they're human, and they come from different perspectives and get to these points where they meet.
Yes.
And it doesn't matter what color your skin is. But those with non-Caucasian coloring...
those with a bit more melanin in their system.
...have had very, very... They are born with these perspectives because of what's going on in their environment and how they are treated. We can't really... I mean, I cannot even imagine... I can't even imagine what it's like. That's what I like about it, is it's, that's why I want it to be real, because I want it to be really telling me and helping me understand what it's like.
Because you can empathize with these characters.
Totally.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that's the thing. And so that question in the back of our head, is this authentic? Gosh, I hope so, because now I feel like I have a glimpse into this world.
But also because what is put out there in media, big screen, little screen, even fictionalized, I think it needs to be true. If you have a bad guy, a villain, and they're black, they need to be a villain because of something more than the fact that they're black.
Oh, absolutely.
But that's my point, is that it can't, the stereotypes of they're bad because they're black, or they're bad because they're Jewish, or whatever it is, needs to...
That comes off as really racist or anti-Semitic, unless there's some kind of humanizing character to this person we've cast as villain.
And we have to be careful, because in the past, you know, the original, of course, you know, there was this new, the new Birth of a Nation movie came out.
Yep.
And it was very controversial for, unfortunately, different reasons. The first Birth of a Nation, though, was a silent movie.
Yes.
And it was putting across stereotypes. This is who they are. This mm-hmm. is what they think and how they think. Yeah. And it wasn't true. It was a lie.
Yeah.
But when we keep propagating those lies, then suddenly there we have the president we have.
No, I think it's healthy and I think it's smart to always be a little cynical about the media that you watch and whether or not it's real when you're watching something that's not about you.
That's a good tip.
I, you know, to me, it is interesting. The people who don't like the show the most are white people on Twitter who are offended because of the title. Well, so that tells me the show's probably on the right track, right?
Correct. And so anyway, I think it's a really good, fun show. And if it is real, if it is true, which I really, really, really want it to be, I just love it. I just fascinate because it's funny. It's quirky. I like the characters. I mean, as far as just good storytelling, check.
So here's the thing, you know, Facebook us, tweet us, let us know what your thoughts on Dear White People are and whether or not
how ignorant, Stacey.
And let's move on to the next one on our list, which is a show I just love. I've seen this one twice too, and I will tell you why. This is a show, it wasn't created by Netflix. Mm-hmm. Netflix didn't make this show, but Netflix does carry it in the US. It's a British show called Happy Valley. And Happy Valley, it's actually two seasons, but they're very short seasons. So it kind of feels like one big kind of Netflix season. And what I really love about this show is it's about characters I've never seen take the lead in a television show before ever in my life. The lead character is a woman. Her name is Catherine Kaywood. She's a sergeant in a police force in this tiny little English town. Mm-hmm.
And it's a village. It's not even a town. It's a village.
Yeah, there are cobblestone streets.
It's a village.
And the hills that surround the town, she goes there whenever she's stressed out and just
everybody knows everybody.
Yes, everybody knows everybody. And she's very much estranged from her family at the beginning of this show, and you're not quite sure why. And she's also taking care of her grandson. Mm-hmm. She's in her 50s, so mm-hmm. she has a grandson who's about seven.
She's 47. She says this in the first episode.
Oh, really?
There's this one moment, and again, it starts out as this little, you think it's going to go one direction.
Yeah.
And then it takes these weird lefts and rights, and it's just bizarre. Here's what I'm going to say about Happy Valley. It is the closest to binging I have ever come in watching mm-hmm. because I'm, as I said, I'm not a binge watcher. I can't do it. Yeah. One or two episodes at a time, I'm good. This one...
It's addictive.
I did four in a row.
It's addictive.
And then the next day, I did a couple more. So over like a course of 4 or 5 days, I was done.
Yeah. Now, as I recall, I wasn't addicted until the second episode. The first one, I was like, am I going to keep watching this? It was pretty good. By the time I was halfway through the second episode, I was so, because then what the show is really about is revealed, and it's a big deal.
It is a big deal. But here's what I'm going to say. As far as I'm concerned, the first episode, it was just another Midsummer Murder.
Until it took a little bit of a turn.
And then it went to a really dark place. Midsummer Murder never goes
to that kind of dark place. So I love these characters. I love the fact that she is 47 years old. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Middle-aged, blue-collar cop in a small town. She is badass.
She is badass, but she's real badass. She's not Jessica Jones, not trying to put down Jessica Jones, but she's not a superhero.
No.
She is working class. Usually in British mysteries, whoever your protagonist is a detective at the very least.
Yep.
She's not.
No.
She's a sergeant.
No.
She is the first one at the door. You know, she's the one who finds the dead bodies and does all the gross work. And she gives the stuff to the detectives, which in season two, detectives come more into it. In season one, it was really a lot of her literal story.
Yeah.
Because she has some drama in her own life that actually plays into... So her personal dramas are part of the big picture drama.
So I'm not going to spoil anything here that doesn't go, like, you know, you have two episodes in, you know, just to kind of set up what this is about. Mm-hmm. She is taking care of her grandson. Her grandson is... troubled. Mm-hmm. He's got some anger issues, this little kid. She's very estranged from her family, and we find out the reason why she's estranged from her family is because she's taking care of her grandson. Her daughter died. Mm-hmm. We find out fairly soon she killed herself, mm-hmm. and that this child was a product of rape. So yeah, Happy Valley is a little bit of a misleading title.
Well, it's the British do that all the time. When they say, you hear them talk about sometimes, well, we're going to play Happy Families, which is a game over there, but it's always in sarcastic mode. Yeah, when they say Happy Families, don't believe it.
Yeah, so
don't
Happy Valley isn't always happy.
No, not happy
but,
at all.
So the main crux of the show, of kind of what's going on, is that she finds out that the biological father of this child is recently out of jail. Mm-hmm. Now, he didn't go to jail for rape.
No.
He got away with that and then went to jail for something else. Mm-hmm. He's now out of jail. He doesn't know that he has a child.
Correct.
Has no idea that this rape resulted
in
a pregnancy.
So there are some soap opera aspects of it, which a lot of binge shows are going to have that, because you are getting into the nitty gritty, because you have so much time.
Yeah.
You're able to delve into these personal stories and all of this.
And yet it's done so well. It doesn't feel over the top because, you know, these things do happen. I mean, women are assaulted, you know, and people go to jail.
Correct.
And so it's done in such a way. Now, the guy who plays kind of the main villain of this piece,
is hysterical, because before I saw this, loved him. I mean, I still love him. Don't get me wrong. He's an actor. So it's not like he really did these things. But I had only seen him in Murder at Pemberley, where he played a good guy.
Yeah.
And then I watch Grantchester.
Okay.
Where he is a priest.
A priest.
Well, he's an Episcopal, you know, he's a Church of England priest.
Okay.
So he can have sex and whatnot. But but he's a good guy. And it's so fascinating.
He's very good looking. I mean,
Good, which is why I've always had a crush. And then suddenly I'm watching Happy Valley, where he is not.
No.
He's awful.
He's horrifying.
And he's a really good actor, because I will tell you, I believe him in every single thing I've seen him in.
And this is the worst. Yes. And there are moments when, you know, there's just, he's having what's a very quiet scene with another character.
And a new season of Grantchester is out too, by the way. So if you want to see him in a nice,
completely different thing.
And I believe Grantchester 1 and 2 is on Prime. So if you have that, as we've already established, you might want to look at that. It's more like Midsummer Murders, although there's some darkness there too.
I liked him, and he's, you know, and again, not a bad looking guy, but you know, he's a good actor, because
he's
terrifying in this show. Spectacularly.
Now you'll
creepy.
See a lot of people that you recognize from Harry Potter and everywhere.
In Downton Abbey, her sister is Mrs. O'Brien from Downton Abbey. So
she's also the sister is in the one I talked about, Loch Ness.
Okay.
Which is the one that they're dropping once a week, unfortunately. But I didn't realize that until I was 4 in, and I realized I still had to wait.
Yeah, good British actors just pop up.
They do.
You know,
they're all
in all kinds of
Brits
things.
Brits don't care where they work. They don't care. They're not like American actors who are like, I don't know whether I'm going to do that role or not. How will that affect me and my PR? Brits don't care. They want to work. That's why Richard Harris and James Mason and Michael Caine do some shit. There is crap out there with their names on it, and they didn't care.
Although Michael Caine did say about 10 years ago, I'm not going to do crap anymore. I just don't feel like it. And, you know, but it's like, it was this total admission that, if somebody called him with a job, he was like, I'll do it. When do I show up?
Oh, no, blame it on Rio. Did you ever see that piece of crap?
No. Was it bad?
Awful.
Okay, so we are going to take our final break here, and then we're going to come back and talk about Stacey's favorite binge. So if you're curious about what Stacey's favorite binge might be, you'll find out in just a moment when POPeration returns.
In our final segment, Stacey tells all about the one and only show that really categorizes her as a binger. Also, our final diagnosis on binging, coming up on POPeration.
And we're back. POPeration. I'm Stacey.
I'm Eric. And we are talking about binging. So you have a favorite binge.
I do have a favorite. Stacey. Now, and again, I've talked about how I don't really binge in that I don't sit and do all of them at once.
Mm-hmm.
The closest I've come, there were three. There were three different ones. I talked about Happy Valley.
Yep.
And that's like the most recent.
Brilliant.
Another one that I came the closest was The Keepers, which was a documentary.
Yes, which
we'll talk about in another episode, but I'm just saying that was, I watched 4 in a row.
Yeah.
And then I had to take a really long break.
Yeah.
But this one was the first one that I think I watched the whole season. Well, there were only 30 minutes at a time, I think. So I think I may have watched the whole season one night. The Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt.
which is delightful and
it's
charming.
It's absolutely hysterical. And by the way, when I took a break after The Keepers, which we'll talk about again, this was the show I went to. I had to cleanse my palate. Mm-hmm. I went to Kimmy Schmidt.
It's a nice palate cleanser from disturbing things. Correct. That, you know, are violent and
but
awful.
I enjoyed this. It's Tina Fey produced, mm-hmm. and she's actually in some of it as a drunk psychiatrist, psychologist, whatever. She's fabulous. It is. Some people have had issues with the premise, and I get that to an extent.
I was about to say, when I heard the premise, it didn't sound nearly as charming and delightful as it ended up being. So the premise is that this girl's been locked away in a bunker.
In a cult. She's been in this cult,
yeah.
Mormon-esque, you know,
okay.
If we're going to go there, it's this guy had these wives, mm-hmm. and he kept them in a bunker.
Yeah.
It was John Hamm.
Prisoner.
Plays. Yeah,
they were
prisoners,
you know, so.
And she was kidnapped when she was like 16.
Or something.
Something like that. And she escapes. She and she helps the other women. I think mm-hmm. There were 3 or 4 women
yeah.
that were wives.
And in the very first episode, they show up in New York to be on some TV show mm-hmm. Talking about their ordeal, some mm-hmm. kind of Jenny Jones-esque kind of thing. And
wow,
then,
that's a name from the past.
Isn't it?
Wow, I haven't thought of her.
I have a mind like a steel trap.
Wow. There was Jenny
but
Jones.
But something like that. And then she just decides halfway through, she just says, get me out of the car. I'm staying here. I'm staying in New York mm-hmm. City. And all these other girls are like, are you nuts? And step one is find an apartment. So she just kind of, and then find a job and yeah. then make a life for herself. And she does it. And she is this, you know, the sunniest,
yeah,
you know.
She's very Pollyanna to
yeah.
the power of 104. And naive. Mm-hmm. Although I like that as the series goes on, she is learning and she is becoming more sophisticated. Now, put that in perspective, she's not. But then, as Tina is wont to do, she's surrounded by all of these wonderfully colorful characters
yeah.
that have their own lives and agendas. But everybody's so freaking funny.
They're all like, funny. There are comic geniuses on this show.
Titus Burgess.
Titus Burgess is, yeah.
I love him so much.
Yeah.
My daughters love him so much. He's the best thing on Match Game. He's the best thing on Match Game.
Oh, is he on Match Game now?
Yeah. Do you watch the new What Match Game?
No.
You haven't watched the new Match Game
no.
with Alec Baldwin as the host?
No.
Oh, my God.
Okay.
Okay, we'll talk game shows at some
all
point.
All right.
It's
another
hysterical.
Episode for another day.
And what's funny about that, real quick, is that so I had seen there were reruns of the 1974, Match Game 1974-75, which uh-huh. I watched as a child
yes.
when it was on. And I had gotten my girls into watching that. And,
uh-huh.
of course, that was Charles Nelson Reilly and all of that fun.
Yep.
And then suddenly, here comes Alec Baldwin with a new version, and it can be very, very funny. But Titus Burgess is on.
Oh, I bet.
I love him so much.
Well, before Kimmy Schmidt came on the air, I had this whole thing in my head. Like, every once in a while, I would kind of go back to memories of Taxi, which I always loved. And I thought, whatever happened to Carol Kane? Like, whatever happened to Carol
well,
Kane?
She was
so fun.
She'd do bits and pieces.
And she was. Little bits and pieces. Mm-hmm. And this, she's back.
She's back.
She's been in every episode.
I think so, because she's the landlady.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think so. She's wonderful in it. Everybody's comic timing is just stupid. And then What's-Her-Face the Blonde from
Jane
Dirty
Krakowski.
Rock. Holy cow. And again,
yeah.
she's playing the same narcissistic kind of character. but it's a little
but
different.
But she's good at it.
And yeah. this season, which is season 3, I guess we're on.
Oh, I think we're like up to season 5 or something crazy.
No, where are we? I forget what season we're on because they all run together because I just watch them. Anywho, she, on this season, we just won't name a number. On this season, it's hysterical because it's got a local for us because she's part Native American. That's part of her backstory. So she's trying to get the name of the Redskins changed.
Okay.
And so there's like this big convoluted and she's fallen in love. It's just very funny and clever, and it is a little bit of cotton candy
mm-hmm.
in that it tastes really good, but you don't necessarily retain it for a long time.
Yeah,
but you do have a good feeling about it. So it is like a go-to for me.
So I've seen some of Kimmy Schmidt. I have not seen all of it.
Okay.
And what I will tell you is the half-hour sitcom style doesn't really work for me anymore, and I think it's because I've been taken over by this bingey culture. If something doesn't have a cliffhanger ending and I don't need to see it either immediately or the next day, I sometimes find it just slips my mind and I don't come back to it, which is why things like Jessica Jones or Happy Valley or, you know, even The Crown kind of had this thing on, you know, they always kind of tease up like what's going to happen next. And I, the plot has to kind of suck me in.
That's interesting. Because I'm like directly the opposite.
Yeah.
I don't want that. That's why I like the things that tie up at the end. Mm-hmm. Now, again, I get it that that's the stuff we've talked about, Happy Valley, done clean up.
Yeah. It does by the end of the season.
Right.
But in the midst of it all.
But
yeah,
I'm aware of that. Kimmy Schmidt is not your typical sitcom, though.
No.
It's not your three camera with an audience sitcom.
No.
It is more along the lines of those that don't, which I think is always smart. Now, if I see a sitcom that has an audience or a laugh track, I'm rolling my eyes and I'm turning away.
We've become a little bit more sophisticated.
I don't tell me when to laugh.
Yeah.
Don't effing tell me when it's supposed to. If it's not funny,
yeah,
I'm not going to laugh.
Mm-hmm.
And you sitting there turning up the knob of the canned laughter is not going to make it funnier to me.
No.
But I also think we're way more sophisticated than that.
Yeah.
Because, again, we talked about YouTube and all of that stuff. They don't have laugh tracks. Mm-mm. And they don't need them. And I think we're just beyond that. And it sounds hokey. It sounds old. And I realized people got really upset when Last Man Standing got canceled. But it's one of those, all of those that have that audience.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're going away.
I mean, honestly, a live studio audience where the laughter is genuine, you know,
always,
is better than a laugh track.
They always buff it.
Yeah.
They always puff it up.
Yeah.
More.
And just.
But that's not what Kimmy is. It doesn't have that.
No.
It has more of that kind of documentary feel that The Office and 30 Rock and that people
took
on.
But you know, the only thing I watch these days that's in that half hour time mm-hmm. frame format is that Grace and Frankie. It's
okay.
The only show. And I think what kind of keeps me hooked into that is just, you know, at the and I don't know if season three will be as enjoyable to me, because mm-hmm. what was great about Grace and Frankie to me was that at the first episode, Grace and Frankie hated each other.
Correct.
But then their husbands announced they were divorcing them and marrying each other. And suddenly they had this common bond over the fact that this humiliating, heartbreaking thing was happening. And so it kind of had that story. And then they moved in with one another. And then it just kind of things mm-hmm. kept piling on. And so far, when I as far as I got into season one of Kimmy Schmidt, it was just, you know, she was each episode was a new milestone in terms of I landed the apartment and now I got this job and now I found this.
And the first season is very much that. And to an extent, that's what happens. But then it's always her trying to get to the next level of self-discovery.
Mm-hmm.
So this season, she's going to college. She's figured out how to get into, you know, she needs to go to college. And so she's figured out. So, yes, there's a bit of that is still going on mm-hmm. in it. But it's not that immediate toddler learning curve that you have in the season one.
Yeah.
Where everything is completely new.
Shiny and new. And
shiny
she's got
new,
big eyes and she's just,
correct.
You know, kind
I mean,
of
she's
just
still, but she's still optimistic.
Sure.
That is who she is. But you're
and
also
I would hate
seeing
for
more.
That, I would hate for that show to lose that. That's kind of, that's what the Unbreakable and
correct.
Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt's all about.
And but you're also, get to delve into more of the other characters and their stupid stuff that they're going through.
But you know, one of the things that we're learning the more we talk about TV is just there's so much. And not everything has to appeal to everybody, because there can't be a show out there that everyone needs to watch because no one's got that kind of time.
No.
We all pick and choose, and it's great that we all get to watch whatever appeals to us. But on the other hand, you know, we talked about this when we talked about The Cosby Show a couple of episodes ago. Everyone watched The Cosby Show, and now there's mm-hmm. nothing that everyone watches. And not only does all of these shows that are available on streaming make it that there's too much content, but we all watch them at our own pace. And so there's not these cultural touchstone moments. Now, I think when the series finale of your favorite show, Game of Thrones, happens, there's going to be a lot of conversation about that among the fans, because everyone who watches that show will be home on Sunday night watching it unfold live, because there is no...
I think they do that with Game of Thrones. There are several shows that's happening. That's still happening, because you got to be on Twitter or Facebook the next day, and you've got to either know...
It's going to be spoiled.
Yeah.
Who eventually sits on the Iron Throne is not going to be a secret that people are going to be willing to keep for long, because that is a weekly thing. And
right.
and luckily, you know, for folks like you, you won't care. For folks like me, I'll need to watch it that night,
you have
or
to.
I will be on social media blackout until I can get back to my DVR to watch that show.
That is where we are in the 21st century.
Yeah.
That you have the social media, it truly does.
And yet, I do see people, like when you're talking about Orange is the New Black on social media, will be like, okay, I just watched episode 7, so I don't know where you are. So no spoilers, but you know, go into the comments if you've seen it, because I want to talk about it.
And also places will say, okay, we've got spoilers here, so if you don't want to know, don't read past this.
Because you can't take for granted that everyone's at the same place that you are, because 10 episodes drop at once. Yep. So we've kind of we've dipped our toes into our final diagnosis about binging. Thoughts based on this conversation?
Binging per se, I'm not a binger. I'm not. I can't just do a whole slew of them. And again, there are exceptions to the rule. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, I pick and choose. I have an episode here or an episode there. Then I'll change to a different show and I'll do this. What I like about things being dropped all at once is that I don't have to wait if I don't want to.
Mm.
I like the choice. I like having the choice. So I'm for them all being dropped at once. But I will say, as a person, because I do see all these people, these acquaintances of mine who are like, I just, you know, House of Cards just dropped and I saw it was crazy. I don't know where they're getting the time, frankly. But Godspeed to them. Okay, great. Glad you're able to do that. That's not what I do. But I do like having the choice. And so I think it's kind of a cool. And as you said, I think we're in a golden age, a new golden age. A regolding of the age. I don't know how you'd put it. Somebody will phrase it perfectly and we'll all hashtag it. It'll be great.
Yeah.
But that's
how
I am. I like it, but it's the choice that I like.
I don't binge in that I'm not going to watch 10 hours of television for one show in one weekend. But I do find that now that most of the stuff that I watch is these kind of streaming bingeable shows that all drops at once, I do watch one TV show at a time. And I actually kind of like that. And I like the freedom of watching it whenever I want to. I think we're going to get to a point very soon where I am going to be talking to somebody who is a teenager, and they're not going to believe me when I tell them that you used to have to wait for an entire week to watch the next episode of anything. We've just become kind of entitled, but I'm part of that crowd. And I think it is slowly changing the way these shows are made, in that, you know, the cliffhangers are getting a lot more intense than they used to kind of keep
plugged into
the next one.
You look at network shows and what they're having to do, how they're, you know, Scandal. I mean, you look at some of these shows, Grey's Anatomy, that have had these bizarre Americans, whatever, bizarre cliffhangers, but they have to, because what are they competing with? They're competing with those shows that have dropped all their season at one time on Netflix that doesn't have commercials, by the way.
And you know what? I know people who are now binging Breaking Bad and Mad Men.
True.
Friends. Mm-hmm. I mean, all of these shows that... So I think for Scandal, you know, I would probably... I stopped watching Scandal a couple of seasons ago. It just jumped one too many sharks for me. And I was kind of like, okay, that was fun. And now I can be done with that show. But if I wanted to watch it now, I would go back and watch it on Netflix. And I'd binge it if I wanted to. I'm going back and watching Buffy. So I never actually... Yes. So I'm on season 6 of Buffy. There were 7 seasons. I'm not rewatching. I'm watching them for the first time. But I binge a season of Buffy.
Wait, you're watching them for the first time?
I'm watching them for the first time.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. So
I didn't know that was who you were.
I binge a season of Buffy when there's nothing else that's on my list, you know? And so I'll go back to season 6 when I'm done watching whatever it is I'm watching now. And then I'll go watch something else that just came out on Netflix. And then I'll watch season 7. It's great that I can just kind of... focus on, what are you watching now, Eric? I have one television show that I'm watching, and I find that I prefer it. It's just, it's completely changed the way I watch TV.
My daughter's watched, you know, Once Upon a Time, which was on TV, but she's able to go back and watch earlier seasons again.
Yep.
And that's the thing, is that you can go back and watch it again. You know, for me, Buffy is, that's an again. I saw them all in real time. When they came out, I was a huge Buffy fan. I watched Angel as well.
Yep.
That's who Stacey is, in case you were wondering. And so I think it's great, though, because I also, again, I don't watch anything live because I can't stand commercials. So
yeah, we don't have to watch commercials anymore.
Correct. It's awesome. It's really, really awesome.
Yeah. I think it'll be interesting to see, from a cultural standpoint, in maybe 5 or 6 years, we'll be able to really kind of tell how has... dropping an entire season at once, how has it really changed television as an art form? Because it's got to have an impact.
Well, I think it as I said, I think the cliffhangers and the kind of shows that we're now on TV, I mean, there was always Dallas and Dynasty and all of that as your big dramas.
Yep.
Now it's Scandal and these high suspense Americans that have these major stakes going on and cliffhangers that we would never have thought of 10 years ago. I think that's part of it, but you're right. The whole impact, no, we haven't seen it yet. We can't see it yet.
It'll be interesting to see.
So, but I think it's fun. I think binging is good, and if that's the way you go, great. If not, it's good to have the choice.
Yeah.
That's
freedom.
Where I am. That's Merca. Where I am.
Merca. Hashtag Merca. I'm Eric.
I'm Stacey.
Please subscribe, rate us, and review us, and check us out on PopOrationRoom.com, and we will see you the next time.
You've been listening to POPeration with Eric and Stacey. Check out our website at PopOrationRoom.com for links to our blog and other extras. Don't forget to subscribe to POPeration via iTunes, iHeartRadio, Stitcher, Google Play, YouTube, and other podcast locations. You can also follow at POPeration Room on Facebook and Twitter. Music provided by PurplePlanet.com.